Okay, shall I go ahead, Deepa?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, please. Yeah.
Professor Ramakrishnan, Director TFR, Professor Biruj Arora, Professor Umar Ramakrishnan, Professor Subhra Chunawala, Dean Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, Dr. Deepachari, host of today's program. Many previous awardees of the Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education are with us today. My colleagues at the Homi Bhabha Center and at TIFA, very warm welcome to you this afternoon on this for this function, which is the award handing over of the Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education. I trust that all of you are safe and well, and also your closed ones. It is tough times and very difficult times for all of us. On behalf of all of you, express also my sympathies, those who are suffering across the country and elsewhere. It would have been a great occasion if we could all meet together at the Homi Bhabha Center. We've had the previous award functions there. It's always been a thing to be cherished, to be remembered. It would have been wonderful to have you all here on the campus, but we do the best possible under the circumstances, and we're really happy to be able to organize the online thing, and I'm happy that Professor Umar is here with us to give the talk. We also received a message from Dr. Satyanarayana. He could not be with us due to unavoidable circumstances, but we hope that there will soon be an occasion where he will also be addressing us. So the Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education was instituted in the year 2006 through a generous endowment made by Professor Biruj Arora, who is also here, for work in science education defined very broadly. It has been given every 2 years since 2006. Since 2020, the award is given to two awardees every 2 years. Thanks once again to another generous endowment by Professor Biruj Arora. So, in fact, for the first time in 2020, we have two awardees whose names will be announced today and the citations read. To give you a bit of a background, let me just mention the previous awardees of the Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education. In 2006, it went to Professor Bhaktavar Mahajan of the Homi Bhabha Center. In 2008, it went to Professor V.G. Gambhir of the Homi Bhabha Center. I'm very happy that he is able to join us today. Welcome to you, sir. In 2012, it went to 2010, sorry, it went to Professor Arnab Bhattacharya from TIFR. In 2012, it went to Professor Sudhakar Agarkar, who's also with us. Welcome to you, Professor Agarkar. In 2014, it went to Professor Vijay Singh of the Homi Bhabha Center, formerly. There was also an honorable mention to Sri Anand Ghaisas, also of the Homi Bhabha Center. In 2006, the award was given to Dr. Vivek Montero. In 2018, the award went to Professor Anil Sadgopal. And in case you're wondering why all these names are all only from the TIFR extended family, I'd like to inform you that the award is for members, current and past members. That's the alumni of TIFR. And proudly to, it gives us a lot of pride to say that all the names, even those whom you may not immediately associate with TIFR, are all associated with TIFR. They're either members or former members or alumni of TIFR. So this is the background to the award. Today we have two awardees, and I invite Professor Ramakrishnan, Director TIFR, to hand over the award and also to read the citation. Over to
Thank
you,
you.
Professor.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ravi. I'm extremely glad to be a part of this event. I consider in these troubled times, even though this is an online event, it's like a silver lining. I think we need something to be positive about. And I am extremely glad that this 2020 award is given to two recipients equally deserving and coming from two different disciplines. I think the award winners, let me first announce Dr. B. Satyanarayana from High Energy Physics Group of CIFR and Professor Uma Ramakrishnan from NCBS, Bangalore. So let me first read the citation for Dr. B. Satyanarayana. The Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education 2020 is presented to B. Satyanarayana for his active leadership and sustained efforts in engaging with society at large and college students in particular through developing lectures and experiments, demonstration, especially in electronics, nuclear and high energy physics, and other science, engineering and technology topics that have reached colleges in small and remote locations across the country. An active engagement with outreach activities of TIFR and INO, that is India-based Neutron Observatory, science exhibition from local to national levels, and the organization of ASSET. This is a famous colloquia, Advanced in Science and Engineering and Technology series of colloquia in TIFR for over a decade, and spearheading novel initiative such as skill and knowledge enhancement programs called SKEP of the IEEE. So the award is, unfortunately, he is not here because of some family emergency, but I think we will give the award to him for his excellent contribution to the science education. The second one is given to Professor Uma Ramakrishnan. The citation reads as, the Homi Bhabha Award in Science and Technology 2020 is presented to Professor Uma Ramakrishnan for her outstanding contributions towards conservation biology. She has extensively used conventional and online science communication platform to highlight and bring concepts related to extinction, conservation, evolution, and biodiversity to a wide section of society, and fostered interactions with various government agencies and other stakeholders that have impacted national strategies for conservation of ecology. So this award is given to Professor Uma Ramakrishnan.
Thank you.
Over to Ravi.
Thank you very much, Professor Ramakrishnan, and congratulations to Professor Uma Ramakrishnan. I'll now hand over to Dr. Deepachari for the rest of the program.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Subramaniam, and also Professor S. Ramakrishnan for starting the function. And I think it's now time to listen to one of the public talk of Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education 2020 recipient, by Professor Uma Ramakrishnan. Sorry, I think I. My name is Deepa Chari, and I will introduce the speaker shortly. But I'm mostly here to do timekeeping and also coordinating the session and question and answer. So overall, we have about an hour. So Uma, you can decide to take questions at the end, or like you would like to have questions in between as well. And we'll try to take questions from Zoom as well as we'll cover some questions from YouTube if possible, which I can try to read it out for you at the end. So our first speaker is Professor Uma Ramakrishnan, and she is popularly known as wildlife conservation biologist. And Professor Ramakrishnan is a current professor of ecology and evolution at the National Center for Biological Sciences, NCBS, TIFR Center in Bangalore. And her research work is primarily in the area of conservation genetics of endangered species, emerging infectious diseases, and molecular ecology. And Professor Mak has received her doctorate in biology from University of California, San Diego in USA in 2010. And subsequent to that, she did postdoctoral fellowship at Stanford University for about 2 years. And later in February 2005, she joined National Center for Biological Sciences in India, and where she is currently working as a professor in ecology and evolution. And her work deals with standardizing genetic methods to study biodiversity. Of course, we'll know a lot about it today, and also to study population rise as well as decline of certain species, and even how biodiversity is created by studying a spectrum of geographical locations in Indian subcontinent. And I'm sure she has many interesting observations to share about Western Ghats, and I'm like really looking forward for that as well. And her work with the endangered species like tigers in India is very well recognized nationally as well as internationally. Professor Ramakrishnan has received several awards and recognition in past 15 years. She's a fellow of Indian National Science Academy. And in 2017, she received Senior Investigator Award by DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance. She was a Fulbright Fellow in 2016. She also received a Parker Gentry Award by the Field Museum in Chicago for her extensive research in the area of population genetics, evolution history, and conservation of tigers and other mammals in India. She also received a Wired Innovation Fellowship in 2014, and she has been an Inc. Fellow in 2013. In 2012, the Department of Atomic Energy also felicitated Professor Ramakrishnan with an Outstanding Scientist Award. Professor Ramakrishnan has published over more than 100 research papers in reputed journals like PLOS Genetics, PLOS Neglected Tropical Diseases, Molecular Ecology, and her papers have over 3,000 plus citations, which acknowledges the impact of her work within the science research community. She has also served in the editorial team of Conservation Genomics, Frontiers in Ecology and Environment, and Frontiers in Conservation Science at leading positions. And particularly in the pandemic period, she has been involved in setting up a pop-up COVID-19 testing laboratories with three other faculty members at NCBS in STEM. And this facility has tested over 1 lakh samples since April 2020. Professor Ramakrishnan has also been a part of content team of COVID Gyan, which is an initiative to archive COVID-19 outbreak related resources, which are gathered for informational purpose and also for awareness. So we all feel very privileged to listen to the public talk by Professor Uma Ramakrishnan, who is such a passionate biologist and ecologist. And we hope to get some insight about genetics and biodiversity area, particularly through her most recent work in relation with the endangered species. So without any delay, now I request Professor Uma Ramakrishnan to present her talk, which is titled as Understanding, Discussion, and Communication about Indian Biodiversity. So thanks again, and please proceed, Professor Ramakrishnan.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for that wonderful introduction. I'm a little nervous about the talk today because I'm trying to actually talk more about not science alone, but the other activities that we've been involved in. So before I start, you know, before you get distracted by the slides, I wanted to say that all of us are, you know, heartbroken and in despair about what is happening internationally, nationally, and right around us. And it feels almost a little sad to be talking today in the middle of this, you know, really terrible situation we're in. But as a scientist, while I pause in sorrow, I also feel that science and technology is the way forward through knowledge, evidence for the future. So I truly believe that. I'm not just saying it. And I hope that we can all be part of contributing to that future. So thanks very much for this honor. It's really an honor for me. And I'll go ahead and share my screen and start my talk. So I changed the title a little bit. But basically, you know, I guess for me, the bedrock of all my activities or everything I do is wonder and curiosity. And this is kind of simplistic, maybe. And sometimes I have wondered as a scientist, shouldn't I be more, just objective and look at the, the most important question, what's paradigm changing? But I've been lucky to have been able to just wander around curiously investigating things which caught my fancy. Part of this is also because I've been at TIFR, which allows such freedom of research exploration. The other thing which I should say right in the beginning is this award, though in my name, is not to me at all. I'm very, very lucky to have worked with an incredibly passionate and fantastic set of colleagues, students and postdocs. And some of them are here, not all of them. Most of the pictures you'll see today are by Prasenjit Yadav, who was in the lab, but later decided to become a photographer. He's a professional photographer with National Geographic. So some of the people whose work outcomes of their work I present will be shown here, but there are many others whom I couldn't chance on pictures in the last minute. So thank you to all of you whom I've had the pleasure and honor to work with. This is actually a testament to your efforts, much, much more than anything else. So what I'll do today is just do a quick tour, eye candy of India's biodiversity, and talk about how through these 15 years of research, teaching and communication, I've had the opportunity to work on things like tigers and their conservation, biodiversity in the Western Ghats, and just scratching the surface, just starting, because it's such a complex and deep place in terms of knowledge, Northeastern India. And hopefully also in the end, I hope you'll be convinced that none of this is on my own. It's all a very, very combined effort with many, many people participating. So there's a picture from the Western Ghats, and you can see these beautiful forests from there to the northeast. This is Meghalaya, again, very wet and, tropical, subtropical. The dry areas, the arid areas of central India, which also have these, kind of ponds or wetlands. This is Barasingha you see in Kanha Tiger Reserve, to the cold and high elevation habitats in the Himalayas. This is a photograph from Sikkim in winter. And the spectacular wildlife, from this leopard in Ranthambore to this pair of fighting tigers, also in Ranthambore. The diversity of both vegetation, biomes, habitats, as well as species is really very, very unique and spectacular in the Indian subcontinent. But basically, these charismatic species, unique species, endemic species live amongst a lot of people. And so this is just to remind us that, this elephant herd, as it crosses the road, has to be mindful of the vehicles which are passing by. And this picture taken from a drone in Coorg is kind of really, it really makes us pause, because it makes us realize that what we think of as these pristine large forests are really what is left now, what remains now are fragmented and small patches. And so it becomes a very difficult challenge then for biodiversity, for animals to sustain in these relatively small and fragmented habitats. So I think, biodiversity is something which has been on the international mind of many, on the mind of many people internationally. We've seen in the last few years, climate strikes and many, many calls for declining biodiversity. And one of the, one of the main things that has been stressed is that it's not just that biodiversity is beautiful and eye candy, as I myself just called it, but it's because biodiversity and these ecosystems provide us many services, the water we drink, the air we breathe, and the fruits we eat. And without it, human sustenance is very difficult. And of course, the biggest example for us now is emerging infectious diseases like SARS-CoV-2, which tend to spill over in situations where there is high biodiversity loss and high human-wildlife interface. I've been lucky to participate for the last 15 plus years in a very fantastic master's program in wildlife biology and conservation, which is was initially just housed at the NCBS, but has since been adopted by NCBS TIFR. And we've had the real pleasure to teach, interact with several batches, now 120 graduates. These are master's students admitted every other year. And basically, they are a whole generation of young people who are equipped with skills to try to deal with these problems of wildlife and its conservation. The problem is quite simple. Like I just said, India is a megadiverse nation with 4 biodiversity hotspots and the last remaining populations of many of these charismatic species. India, for example, holds 75% of the world's tigers. So if tigers are to survive, it will only be in India, right? And unfortunately, this coincides with 1.3 billion people and 5% of its area, which is protected. So, being engaged with the students, teaching them 2 courses through their master's program, taking on many students for their master's thesis, provided an opportunity to really convey these concepts about conservation, and especially my perspective, which comes from a genetic lens, a kind of a technological approach and a deconstructionist approach to looking at biodiversity. And this program has been extremely successful. I'm not taking credit for it at all. These slides are in fact courtesy Jayashree Ratnam, who's the program director. But something like 50% of the students who finish this master's program directly join the workforce in conservation science and practice. Practice means they're actually doing things on the ground to facilitate conservation. About a half of them actually end up doing PhDs, but subsequent to their PhDs, continue to work on, and during their PhDs, on Indian wildlife and ecosystems as their research topics. So basically, many of these students end up joining NGOs, academia, and sometimes, very rarely, even forest departments through the IFS or the Indian Forest Service. And very few of them actually leave the field. So basically, this kind of a program over even the last 15 or so years has had a significant impact on knowledge, for sure, in conservation science and biodiversity research in India. Something like 30 to 40% of papers in the last several years have actually been authored by students and alumni. I've also been very lucky to be on the organizing committee and participating with the student conference on conservation science. This is just a snapshot of the report from 2020, where we unfortunately had to have a virtual conference, but this is a really fun conference. It's completely attended by students, and the talks are by students, and save for plenaries, it's a very student-oriented conference. So it gives an opportunity for students from all over the country and internationally to come together and discuss conservation. A key feature of this conference are workshops, and I've, for example, been teaching a workshop on conservation genetics and landscape genetics every year for the last 10 or so years in this conference. And this is a picture of a panel discussion we had on careers in conservation, contrasting careers in, say, academia versus in the NGO sector or in government. And I think these kinds of fora for discussion for students are really important, because it allows them to really think about what they may be going in for when they are going into this field. And it also allows, there are very few institutions where there is research going on in this area of high quality. So it allows students from all over access to people who are doing research in the field and allows them to then kind of build their careers even better. So I'll talk a little bit about tigers now. I won't talk too much about my work, but I've been lucky to work for 15 years on these really charismatic endangered species. And I have to say that I still feel like there's a lot we don't understand. The principal questions we address are looking at, using genetics to understand what the populations of tigers are. Of course, tigers exist in protected areas, mainly in tiger reserves, but it so happens that they are sometimes able to move between protected areas. And so the landscape that they occupy in a genetic sense is larger. However, the ongoing changes are affecting this situation. So basically, though, what I've done is I've used tigers as a tool to study things like conservation, extinction, habitat fragmentation, genetics, and evolution. And I've used them as a scapegoat to actually communicate a lot of these concepts. And many times, because they're so charismatic, that's the only reason I've gotten all of these opportunities to talk at many fora and to participate in articles which are outside of the academic realm. So we all get these opportunities, and I think it's really great to take them up. Sometimes they feel like, oh, another talk, some more work. But on the other hand, for example, with the Ink Talks or the Wire Talk, communicating with audiences who don't know anything about tigers, biodiversity, or genetics, evolution, is really a valuable opportunity for us to communicate concepts in these areas. We've also worked a lot with artists, and we've done this, for example, here we worked with Pooja Gupta, who helped put together this caricature of basically portraying the results of our paper, which suggested that fragmentation results in loss of connectivity, and especially things like human habitation, right? Human habitation results in tigers being cut off from each other. Now, this might sound very, okay, obviously it does, but actually showing it with data is something which I think is very valuable. And we could also do models in this case, simulation models of the future to say, for example, if this development scenario happened, extinction probability would increase by this much. And these kinds of arguments are very powerful, especially when communicating in the context of the legal system. So here again, our work was used in a case, a court case, against the widening of this highway. So basically, this is NH7, which bisects Kanha on this side and Painj Tiger Reserve over here. Painj Tiger Reserve is the famous place where Rudyard Kipling wrote Jungle Book. And our data and data of others as well showed that there is good connectivity or movement of tigers between these two areas. So when this road was to be broadened from a two-lane highway to a six-lane highway, the suggestion was that we thought, and others thought as well, that it would become a barrier and there would no longer be connectivity between these two tiger reserves. So as a result, a natural biological process would be disrupted. So in collaboration with an NGO called Wildlife Conservation Trust and individuals in this NGO who filed public interest litigations, they were able to get a judgment against the NHAI, the National Highway Authority of India, requiring them to build a 700 meter underpass. So basically the road goes up over here, and this allows then animals to move between the protected areas. And recently, so this is a picture from, I think, 2019. This is 2016 when the construction started, and that's when the case started. And then they were able to continue and finish this highway. So in a sense, this has allowed connectivity to continue in the Central Indian landscape. And there's been also data, like camera trap data by others, showing that tigers are still moving. And this has a solution which has actually worked, right? So, apart from this, many times, there are many stakeholders for our results. And one of the biggest challenges is trying to integrate the timelines of research versus communication of issue of these kinds of results to management. So for example, we've been working with the Rajasthan Forest Department for a long time now. We've been working in Rajasthan for about 8 years now on different questions. The last 6 years, we've been working in Ranthambore Tiger Reserve, where we are studying the effects of population isolation on tigers. What happens to them? Do they get inbred? And what is their future trajectory? So for example, you know, this workshop where there is, you know, the plan to introduce tigers into new areas of Rajasthan. And this plan is being made without any scientific, you know, rigorous scientific planning of which individuals to introduce, how many individuals to introduce, where to introduce them, and so on. And sometimes as a scientist, you feel hesitant because actually you don't know what's going to work, right? For sure. You can't say for sure, oh, okay, you take these two individuals, you'll have a successful population. You can only make an educated guess. And many times, you know, the results of your work may not even be published because publications take a really long time. So the paper, for example, which is discussing the effects or potential effects, proving inbreeding and showing the potential effects of inbreeding, is in revision right now. So it's still not even published, right? But we did interact with the Forest Department in Rajasthan, and we did suggest who might be good individuals to introduce as they were planning these new populations. At the same time, on the right-hand side, you can see attending me and my student Vinay attending meeting of, you know, the forest secretary, the state forest minister, the head of forest force, chief wildlife warden in Odisha, where we've been studying melanistic tigers, and our results indicate that the reason for a high presence of melanistic tigers in Odisha, that's the only place they're there, is because of isolation. You know, the fact that this population has no connectivity. And so here, for example, we were trying to argue that how do we allow natural connectivity? How do we allow tigers to actually move from this park in Odisha to other places and vice versa? And that's a very difficult, it's very easy for me to say, but for the forest minister, it's a very difficult conversation. Because, you know, he has to figure out where is this land going to be to allow for connectivity, right? But on the other hand, if we just publish the paper, it's nice, but it doesn't really change the situation on the ground. So we always have to walk this line, you know, between, you know, the scientific results. Of course, without the science or the evidence, there's absolutely no, you know, point of anything else. Deepa, should I stop for something?
No, I'll go ahead, please.
And so on. So anyway, so the other thing is, like I said, because people love tigers, they're a very charismatic species. We got an opportunity to participate in the science train. I don't know whether all of you know about this. It was an initiative by the DST in 2017, 2018. A train was outfitted with exhibits, and this train went all across India, and thousands and lakhs of school children were able to visit this train. And so we designed these exhibits. They actually even got a stuffed tiger from somewhere, I don't know where. And then basically our work was showcased here. And so we were able to basically reach out to many of these, you know, I guess, children from across India. Hopefully they got some perspective of what, how a scientific intervention can be used in the context of conservation. I don't want to, they have a link here, and this is a book we worked with to get on together with Pratham. The idea was it's a reader level one book, and in Ranthambore we work with several assistants, local people who have been working on tigers as part of research teams. They are not trained researchers, but their knowledge of systems and of the area and of tigers is very, very deep. And so in this case, we actually worked with one of our assistants, Mujahid, to help kind of co-write this book, which was illustrated by an artist from Shantiniketan, and is basically brought out by Pratham. And this kind of a book will go all over the country and, you know, give a glimpse of how, you know, how tigers, their life history. It's not much about genetics because it's a reader level one book, but it does communicate some ideas about tigers and their biology. So I'll just move on to the Western Ghats, and a lot of this work we did basically on looking at a speciation as a result of topography of islands, and it's been, you know, primarily spearheaded by then campus fellow postdoc Robin, who's now a faculty at ISO Tirupati, and we showed, for example, that the shape of the mountains, can result in speciation because it results in isolated pockets, which then over time change enough to become different species. And, you know, communicating about tigers, connectivity, in some sense, it was very easy. Okay. But when we started talking about these small birds on the tops of mountains, it was really not easy. It was really not easy. People did not find it very interesting. And on the other hand, though, this kind of communication was very important because many of these habitats where these birds live are very endangered, especially these high altitude habitats in the Western Ghats, the sholas and the grasslands, very unique habitats. So here we were very lucky to collaborate with Prasenjit Yadav, who is the, as I mentioned, the National Geographic photographer. And he, he's a spectacular, and we just helped to, you know, work with him. We just worked with him, told us about the science we're doing, went along with him to the sites we are working and so on. And he was able to actually put together a National Geographic story, which is on the website on Sky Islands. And this is the cover photo. It's the first picture ever of a green meteorite, which he happened to get because he was trying to capture, this is Ooty, and he was trying to capture this night scene, which is actually showing you these mountain tops slightly dark compared to all of this. So basically this concept of sky islands, they are islands in the sky, and basically there are people all around, right? So they are isolated because just like islands in the sea, these habitats are isolated from each other. This sky island is isolated from this sky island, okay? And this was really, I don't want to click here because then I have to switch screens and stuff, but if you have a chance, it's a really spectacular story. And he basically portrayed how we had done this work, how had we understood that the presence of these sky islands leads to speciation or the generation of diversity, novel species. So even that was okay. Like it was. Amol, did you have a question? Or should I keep going? I'll keep going, maybe in the end. So this was also fine, but National Geographic goes out to lots of people. So a lot of people in the world suddenly learned about these beautiful habitats in the Western Ghats. And you know the kinds of unique species that they harbor, right? And there's no way as a scientist, however fantastic a paper I write, I can ever get that kind of reach. So this kind of reach really amplifies any kind of a scientific product or research that is possible by us. But you know what was even more interesting about birds is a lot of people do like birds because they have bird song and they sing. And here again, we were lucky to have this kind of a really, very different collaboration, something I probably never do again, with a beatboxer called Ben Mirren. And this here, I will show you this. But basically what Ben Mirren did was, I'll talk while I'm switching screens. What Ben Mirren did was that he actually, he took these bird songs from the Shola birds, right? And he mixed them to make like these, beatbox. So these are native birds, same birds, which are different species, driven by these sky islands. And he basically mixed this like a music person would do and created these audio tracks. I'll switch back now. Sorry. One sec. And this was something which basically played houseful people in the Western Ghats. So this is Koraikanal, Ooty, you know, all these places. People were so enthusiastic and they really came in large numbers to hear about, through this music, through this sound, hear about speciation, hear about evolution on these sky islands, right? So music is really universal in that sense. And it was really a very different and unique collaboration. He just came down for a few weeks and we did this going to different parts of the Western Ghats. And these birds, which people were hearing every day outside their house, suddenly it came alive as to why they sounded like that, who they were and how they were different from each other. So also this work on biogeography allowed the opportunity for me to actually participate in this iBiology series, which is basically a set of talks which are online. And again, if you look at these talks, most of the examples of evolution, most of the examples that we see in textbooks are all about systems studied in the temperate area, in the US, in Europe, because most of science has really happened there, or maybe Africa, right? But there's very few talks which actually talk about speciation, evolution, conservation in a place like Asia or India. So it was really lucky and nice for me to bring these concepts to students across the world with an Indian system. And I think that was a really special opportunity. So also for the last about 10 years, we've been really lucky to funded by the Department of Biotechnology to be working in the northeast of India. And here we are working on different themes. The first project was on ecology and climate change in the Sikkim Himalaya. And here you can see we had, as part of this project, several PhD students, all of whom are finished now, are in faculty positions, they're Fulbright fellows, and so on, really contributing very extensively to the field. And it was a really amazing opportunity to work in a very different habitat, in a different place in these mountains, but also with people and to bring work together with them to kind of create knowledge and understand more about biodiversity here. And while working in the Sikkim Himalaya, I was generally fascinated by the Himalayas itself. And as Dr. Deepa mentioned, I was lucky to get an opportunity through the DAE Outstanding Fellowship, Outstanding Scientist Award, to actually investigate more about biodiversity there. And one of my students here, Pilot Dovi, who's from Manipur, was very passionate, not just about science, but throughout about communication. He used to regularly run these web of life activities with children from the villages where he worked, close to where he worked. And also we would have evening, you know, movies and things like that. We had to carry a projector and show various kinds of, science films and so on, and have discussions with people about biodiversity. Not only that, he also, has done workshops on, molecular biology and genetics. So sometimes, since there isn't a lot of very active research in many parts of the Northeast, students there not get exposed to many of these things. And so it doesn't become something they think of naturally, of a career in research or something like that. Though they are actually surrounded by biodiversity and the wonder of biodiversity, the science that's playing out of evolution and ecology is actually right around them. Pilot also works on bats, and we have been working recently on emerging infectious disease in the context of bat harvest. I'm not going to talk about that today, but I think this is something which is really going to be a big challenge for communication in the future. Pilot has received grants from the Rufford Foundation, where he's done outreach about bats. Bats provide us many ecosystem services, pest control, pollination, and so on. And yet they do also harbor a lot of viruses. So going forward, I'm very keen to investigate this interface between hazard, the kinds of viruses and they carry, and what might spill over. But at the same time, the communication of this research is going to be very tricky, because it's not just good or bad. there are balances, and whenever there is uncertainty, and you know, both good and bad, communication is always quite difficult. In the second kind of bout of working with the Department of Biotechnology Northeast program, we also worked, and this was kind of a legacy project, which I inherited from Professor Krishnan from DIFR, very passionate about biodiversity, and the Northeast unfortunately passed away very young. And so I helped out with this project on chemical ecology with help from Shannon and several other colleagues. And actually before these online talks and stuff became popular, several years ago, 3 years ago now, of almost 4 years ago, we started these online talks, live talks by you know, scientists. And we had a program with about 10 or 15 colleges in the Northeast, where we would play the talk and then there would be a live interaction for questions. And this was really successful, actually. It was really fun to interact with all of these students. And basically, again, here, this particular program had 15 PhD students. They are not yet finished. This program is still ongoing. And there have been several challenges because of the pandemic for them to kind of finish their work. But with these students, we've organized several, you know, workshops and on things like, you know, writing papers, writing articles and so on, which I think are skills which all graduate students should have. Sometimes some of us are more hesitant to do it, maybe just because we have not been exposed enough to people who have done it, or we've not, you know, seen enough of that. So as I said, you know, the last year has been really challenging, and Dr. Deepa mentioned my participation in helping with the testing facility, and that was, it was, you know, it was at the time, it felt like it was something which had to be done. Today, it almost feels like, I don't know what should be done. What is the role of science at all today? But of course, like I said, we can't give up hope. But in the last year, I've helped not so much recently, but maybe between you know, June and December or January with the COVID Gyan site, which was an inter-institutional effort to bring the best scientific evidence about COVID to the public. And of course, this was a major team effort, and the people whom I worked with, some of the people I worked with, Meena from HBCSC, who was really spectacular to work with, Anand Vaidya from TIFR Hyderabad, and the comms team at NCBS, Mahin, Pavitra, and Chandrakant. And of course, Sandhya before me from TIFR, who handled all of this and much, much more. So, you know, we did different kinds of things, like articles, a cartoon series by Arvind from INSTEM, some interviews which were translated into articles with, in this case, Ullas and Sandeep about the serology study in Mumbai. But all of this kind of really seems now like, okay, now what is the point? Where is this all going? And maybe at this point, we have to just pause and, you know, be human in this current moment. But I think that it is a good time to think about the way forward as well. So I, for one, you know, I can't wait to get back to my field research with my students and try and better understand, you know, what kinds of microbial diversity and pathogen diversity is harbored in biodiverse areas like the Northeast. And then, like all my work, with that research will come communication. Sometimes before, you know, sometimes while the research is going on, and, you know, sometimes after, but it's a continuous process. Communication is not something which you do after the research is done and the paper is published. In many cases, it's too late. So I guess in summary, I'd like to say that the nature of the work we do, because we work outside the lab, requires us to communicate. We have to interface with the forest department. We have to interface with local people. I didn't show any pictures here, but every time we do field work, we work with many, many volunteers from across the country who join us on these field expeditions. And this communication has always enriched us. allowed us to actually think more about the questions we are asking, and hopefully made some difference to others as well. I really wanted to thank TIFR for the extensive support and freedom. I think freedom is something which is not very easy to come by, and that's something which, as a faculty member at NCBS-TIFR, I've experienced. And also, I wanted to say that I'm actually very honored to get this award, because many times I would chide myself saying, well, I'm at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And sometimes I wonder, is this fundamental research? I'm not sure, but that I've been honored by all of you today, I hope says that that doesn't matter whether it's fundamental research or not. So thank you so much, and I'll stop sharing. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Professor Uma Ramakrishnan, for that full of excitement talk. And what really kind of like attracted me in that talk was how all the research that you talked about and like the spectrum of biodiversity projects that you mentioned, how they actually contributed, towards taking strategic decisions for wildlife conservation in India, and like how that all helped the government bodies. So that was quite an inspiration for all of us. And I also appreciate that you took time to explain how the local people, as well as all the students' communities, extensively contributed in this work throughout. So that was quite enriching for all of us as a researcher and also as a community member. So I think that, we can start taking some questions on Zoom. So if people have questions, they can write. And I also see some hands already being raised. So let me just call upon few names. So Amol, would you like to unmute and ask a question? Yes.
Sure. So Umaka, congratulations.
Thank you.
I was, as a non-biologist, I was intrigued with this idea of sky islands. I mean, one would think that, you know, birds fly, so they really don't have to be isolated on some peaks. So is this a common occurrence or a rare occurrence, and does it depend on birds? Can you give some more insight into this?
Yeah. So basically, actually, birds, would be the, because they are mobile species, where we should see the least differentiation or differences. For example, we did not work on frogs, but other studies have shown, have kind of post the results and shown that, you know, with frogs and so on, you see much more differentiation than you do with birds. But the thing is that while they can fly, the top of the mountain is generally cold and wet. So the habitat there, which they are adapted to, is very different from the one at the bottom of the mountain. So even if they could fly, it's too far to the next, because there are most of these are small birds, but basically habitat wise, they can't go like this, or they can't live in the intermediate habitats. So the barrier or the isolation is also by habitat and not just by the fact that they live on these mountaintops.
Yes. Okay, thank you, Amol, for that question. And thank you, Uma, for taking it. While we wait for others to ask questions, I also have one question, just maybe out of my own curiosity. So you spent a lot of time, exploring mountains. And I was just wondering, there's rich biodiversity also maybe on wetlands and also maybe under the ocean. So what kind of inspired you, to choose mountains over others? So, yeah. If you could say
a few things. So that's a great question. I did in my PhD for a little while work on data from marine species, but I don't work in the sea as of now. That's a different skill set. I need to know how to dive, which I don't know how to do scuba diving. Wetlands definitely are, very diverse, but I think more, the issues in wetlands are more around birds. And the diversity of birds microscopic things, which I haven't studied as much. Mostly I study mammals. Sometimes I study birds as well, like with Robin or others. Uh, So it's just been more of a taxa bias and a system bias. Working in the ocean is very tough, for sure. Colleagues who work on coral reefs or other systems, it's very tough, and it really requires a different, physically you need to be able to do it. So that's one of the things I'm wondering now with this work we're, you know, planning to launch on bats, because it's crawling into caves, which are often dark and wet. And, you know, so anyway, we'll see if I'm physically we're up to the challenge.
Okay, great. Thanks for answering my question, Uma. So I think Professor Subramaniam also has raised his hand. Would you like to unmute and ask the question, please?
Yeah, thanks, Deepa. Thanks for a really interesting talk, Uma. I mean, I'm quite envious of, you know, being able to spend those, you know, moments and long times in those beautiful places. But I had, you know, like everyone, I guess I'm also very curious about wildlife. Although this maybe it's more of behavior ecology, but it'd be good to know your view on it. Say it takes, you know, tigers, big mammals. How much of their behavior is, you know, genetically programmed, would you say, and how much is sort of learned from other tigers? Or do you say something about
that? Yeah, I mean, I think that's a tough question. I don't think we have any data based on which we can answer that question. They are solitary overall. So we would imagine that learning maybe initially for something like hunting may play a role. But even tigers, cubs, which are isolated, can learn to hunt, right? So I think we don't have a lot of information on that. But one place where something like this may be relevant, especially in the context of is conflict. So for example, you know, now there's a lot of conflict with tigers because they come out of protected areas and hunt cattle. And so are there risky personality individuals who do this or not? And these are some questions which would be very interesting to definitely ask, and maybe a little bit easier to answer than, you know, a much broader question of how much do they learn behaviorally, because we can't really do too much of individual based observations on tigers like we can do for monkeys. We can watch them, we can identify them and keep watching them. But those kinds of, and elephants also, we can do those kinds of studies. But with tigers, it's much more difficult because they're very elusive and, you know, difficult. I hope that answers your question.
Okay. Thank you, Uma, again. So there's one more question asked by Aditi from HBCC. Aditi, would you like to unmute and ask, or should I just ask on your behalf?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Okay. Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Uma. The talk was really wonderful. So my question is actually about the nature of awareness programs that you mentioned, and also with the schools particularly. So any kind of study that you would undertake would actually have a different implication for the population who lives close to your study site, and a different implication, say, for someone from the city or not, away from your study site. So keeping that in mind, are there some specific criteria that you have in mind when you plan your educational programs, and particularly with young children, if you have any examples to share?
Yeah, so basically I have to say that have not done this in a very structured way, right? We have not, for example, evaluated the impacts of these interventions or our interactions. You know, we've just done it as part of, like, we're there, what do we do in the evenings? We can do this on some free day or something like that. But I think it would be really nice to do it in a more structured way so that we can actually look at what the impact of this is, and whether there is an impact, how to restructure our program such that there might be an impact. Because, I mean, I think that most of the time we just go in as scientists, we go to a place, we study, we come out, right? But it's just that since we are there, we feel like, okay, let's also interact with local kids or the local people. But I think we have not done it in a very study designed way to actually look at that. And that would be something very nice. You know, if anyone is interested, it's not something which I could do because that's not my skill set. But if someone else is interested, it would be very nice to work together with to do that. Because we're going to all of these places, right? We're going to these places. So we have some kind of access, which a lot of people may not even access, but we end up going there, right? It's not like you couldn't go if you wanted to, but we are going there. And so it just is a little less unknown than, you know, if you didn't know about it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Aditi. That's a very good question. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Aditi and Uma once again. So there's one more question by Arnav. Would you like to unmute and ask, Arnav?
Yeah, sure. Hey, Uma, as always, such a fantastic talk. It's so nice to see you and watching all this. So two questions, actually. You know, you've done so much in so many different areas. Where do you think, you know, the impact on biodiversity has been sort of, you know, in terms of deciding policy, etc., has been the most? And the corollary is, do tigers sort of hog the limelight in the Indian context? I mean, is it possible that, you know, the studies on birds or insects or frogs or something else might actually be much more, you know, important to do in the future?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. So I think that I would say that the connectivity work, which resulted in this underpass, was definitely, I mean, something I didn't expect. But I think that was something which I think had the highest implication, as well as the work on sky islands, because for the first time, especially after the beatboxing and stuff like that, the Kerala Forest Department became very proud of these sky islands. And it was a way for them to market it. I mean, market it sounds bad, but you know, like tigers are marketable. But when you say, oh, these are sky islands and speciation is happening here, it's a unique and a new thing. And then you can actually enforce more, you know, protection, okay, as well as maybe tourism or something like that. So those kinds of things, I think that has impact. And there's many opportunities like that. For example, root bridges in the Northeast, which my colleague Prasanjit Yadav has worked on. By the way, all the pictures, almost all, are his photographs that I showed. So I think that there's possibilities to enhance also tourism opportunities which would benefit local people by some of these, bringing like a limelight on a system or a new place or something like that, right? Now, the second question, for sure, tigers hog the limelight. Many other species are doing very, very poorly. The dhole, for example, even if you're talking about charismatic big things, forget about things like frogs, okay? Even if you're talking about mammals, you know, gibbons, dholes, vultures, birds, but you know, so I think that again, this is because it is structured that way. There is a National Tiger Conservation Authority, which has been approved in an act of parliament, and so it has a budget, and so tigers get the limelight. It sounds very bad to say it like that. I mean, it sounds, for a scientist, it sounds like that doesn't make any sense, but unfortunately, conservation functions within a political framework. And so that's why, you know, that's the case. And there's been a lot of effort to try to change this from a tiger-centric approach. I think it'll happen in some time. I hope that answers your question.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Arnav and Uma. So speaking of different animal, I think there is one question we can take. It was asked by Sushant. And his question is, there is a recent introduction of African cheetah to India.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's asking, what are your views about this? And some news articles also claim that it's just a move of government to keep Asiatic lions inside Gujarat, since the forest where cheetahs will be introduced was considered as an alternate home for Asiatic lions outside Gujarat. And African cheetah will be an invasive species. So would you like to give your view on it?
Yeah, so definitely African cheetah is not an invasive species. Well, cheetahs are not an invasive species. Cheetahs existed in India and they went extinct, right? And it's not like the African cheetah is a different species from the cheetahs which lived in India. They're the same species, maybe different because, you know, they've been isolated for a long time, but they're not different species like lions and cheetahs or something like that. Now, The politics of lion relocation, translocation, moving some lions out of Gir to this Park Kuno is definitely, it's very political and it has been going on for many years. And so I don't want to comment on that. Whether this Sita reintroduction will work, I don't know. It's something which is certainly from a scientific perspective, it's a very interesting experiment to think about, that you're introducing another predator into this landscape. How will tigers and cheetahs interact? What will be the interaction and so on? But overall, I have to say that MP, Madhya Pradesh, is very good as far as wildlife management is concerned. They have been very successful. They have high conservation success. They do indulge in a lot of management, which means not leaving things naturally, but changing things also. And so it seems likely that if this were to happen, MP is a, Madhya Pradesh is a potential state. I don't know. I'm curious to know, how do they pick the cheetahs they introduce? Are they genetically distinct from each other? What happens in the future? How does the population take off? So in some sense, I feel like all these are experiments. We can think and say and make suggestions, but whether it works or not is something we'll have to see.
Okay, thank you, Uma. So we can take maybe one last question and it is asked by GN. GN, would you like to unmute and ask questions?
Well, this is not really a question.
Okay, yeah.
Just trying to, I keep wondering about this, because we have so much of technological know-how. Why can't we leave the earth behind and actually use more and more underpasses so that our houses can be on top of the earth and bridges, we already know how to build them. And why should we live on the earth at all? We lost the license to live. I mean, let's leave them to all the others and we just go up. I mean, I'm just inspired by the example that you gave, but I always keep wondering, I keep threatening, almost all my architect friends and keep telling them, why are you covering all the earth by roads and train tracks and all the concrete? I mean, everywhere, particularly if you look at the urban places. Of course, I know that what I'm saying is nothing to do with your talk. Your talk was excellent and it sort of inspires people. But I keep wondering about this idea about, it's time, I think, that we have to think of leaving more and more breathing space for the earth and not put concrete on the road, on the surface of the earth. And we have an example here.
Yeah, that's a fantastic point. I mean, that's a fantastic point. And I can't say immediately, but I know, for example, in this NH7 case, push comes to shove, it was about money. Building an underpass is a very expensive thing compared to just laying the road on the ground. So in economies where, it's really about money, it's not something which is easy to do. Now, for example, in the US, there are certain counties in Arizona and other places where they have a special tax which you can pay to allow for, which goes towards underpasses for wildlife. Okay, so you can actually contribute to that. And it's not something which is coming out of the contractor's budget or some such thing. It's something which is coming out, additionally. So I think that maybe those kinds of solutions in, better economies might be possible. I'm not sure how we can do it in a place like India. I can tell you that from my very limited experience, construction quality of any infrastructure in remote locations is very poor. So I really, let alone a road, the idea of these, I would imagine that such construction would have to be done very well.
All right. Thanks again, Gian, and thank you, Uma, for addressing this question. So, if there are no more questions, I think we have now almost come to the end of this function. And so I take an opportunity to thank everyone who were involved throughout this. So my particular thanks, first of all, to and also congratulations to Professor Uma Ramakrishnan for winning the Homi Bhabha Award in Science Education 2020 this year. I also would like to congratulate Dr. B. Satyanarayanan, who couldn't be here, but is also the other recipient of Homi Bhabha Award for
Science Education 2020. And thanks to Professor S. Ramakrishna, TIFR Director, and Professor Subramaniam. And also thanks to HBCAC Dean, Professor Chunawala, who they all helped us to organize this event. And also thanks to Professor Arora for the generous support to hold this event and make it possible, actually. So I also thank all the tech team who managed this event successfully on an online platform, and Dean's office for the overall management of this function. Thanks to everyone who had been involved in the nomination process, also in the review, and lastly to the audience who really, I think it was a treat for all of us today, both visual treat and as well as to see how, you know, we all could sensibly contribute in biodiversity project, irrespective of like what is your area of expertise and discipline. Like if you have interest, definitely there is some hope for all of us to contribute in quite full of excitement projects that you mentioned, Uma, today. So thanks everyone, and I hope that Professor Uma's talk has inspired all of us to see our responsibilities and help through science education research to contribute in awareness of enhancing the awareness of our responsibilities towards nature, towards environment overall. So on that note, thanks again, and I now declare that the program is over. Yeah, thank you, Uma.
Thank you so much. Thanks everyone.
Bye. I think we'll all just give a round of clap to
we
Uma.
Should.
Thank you, Uma.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.